If you've been walking the same old road for miles and miles, if you've been hearing the same old voice, tell the same old lies, if you're trying to fill the same old holes inside, there's a better life, there's a better life. If you got pain, he's a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom, a savior, he's a prison shaking savior. If you got chains, he's a chain breaker.
All right, good morning, everybody. Thank you so much for joining us. Isn't it good to be in God's house this morning? So glad that, I don't know where everybody's at. They got an extra hour of sleep. They should still be here. I don't know, but thank you for joining us from home. If you're watching from home, we're honored to have you, to host you online via Facebook Live. Thank you for joining us. Now, a couple quick announcements. First of all, tonight, Awana meets at 5:30. So if you have a child that's Awana age, you can bring them tonight at 5:30. Also, we do have seating during our 9 a.m. service next door for those who want to be extra cautious and take extra measures against COVID. You have a set-away space in the chapel next door for that. During our 11 o'clock service, we do have nursery and children's church that has started back up. So praise God for that, all right? Don't forget about Awana tonight at 5:30. Wednesday night, we have a very special teacher, Reverend Greg Vogt. My dad's going to be doing a teaching on how what is going on in the Middle East corresponds to the end time event. So if you're interested in that, you don't want to miss Greg. He's going to be teaching on that this Wednesday night. Also on Wednesday night at 7 p.m. is the Awakening Youth is meeting. So they're meeting in the chapel on Wednesdays at 7. You'll notice we got the Operation Christmas Child boxes up here. As a church, we want to try and pack 220 boxes. So you can go on Realm, you can contact Miss Jerry Jensen or the church office. If you would like to donate those, we've got empty boxes on the back table that you can pick up if you'd like to help stuff some of those boxes. Right now, Awana and the youth group are in competition with one another to see who can pack the more boxes. The winner gets a pizza party and the loser has to serve the winner pizza. So I just like that. I think that's cool. It's so great to see the young people of this church giving back to children that are less fortunate. These boxes help bring the gospel all around the world to children who will not get anything else for Christmas this year. That's what we're called to be. Amen. Called to be generous. Also, a big time announcement. I wanted to let everybody know we have completed phase two of our 2020 vision. Over $60,000 now has come into the building fund. So the engineers were here this week. They were surveying the land. We're going to have some real pretty blueprints and plans to show you, hopefully, within the next several months. And stay tuned for phase three. We're going to launch that at the first of the year. All right, let's get up on our feet and let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we just thank you for the opportunity to gather and to worship you. We thank you, O God, that you are the Lion and the Lamb. You're the Lion of Judah. You fight our battles for us. You go before us. You're a conquering King. We praise you for that. We thank you that you're also the perfect Lamb of God that was slain for our sins so that we could have relationship with you. Lord, we just pray you'll bless this service, bless this time as we glorify your holy name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Our God is the Lamb, the Lamb was slain for the sin of the world. His blood breaks the chains. Every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Every knee will bow before Him. God who comes to save is here to set the captives free. For who can stop the Lord Almighty? Our God is the Lion of Judah, roaring with power and fighting all battles. Every knee will bow before Him. Our God is slain for the sin of the world. His blood breaks the chains. And every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Oh, every knee will bow before Him. Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord? Our God is the Lion of Judah, is roaring with power. Every knee will bow before Him. Our God is the Lamb that was slain for the sin of the world. His blood breaks the chains. And every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Every knee will bow before. Let's give it up for the Lord this morning. You took these lies, replaced the scars. Made me your child, no longer a slave, and I'm set free. Oh Lord, I'm set free. Oh Lord, I'm set free. I'm free in You. Yeah, I'm set free. Oh Lord, I'm set free. Oh Lord, I'm set free. I'm free in You. You led me out, draw me near, found me to love and not to fear. Through all the earth, Your freedom rings. Release my soul, and now I sing, and I'm set free. Oh Lord, I'm set free. Oh Lord, I'm set free. I'm free in you. Yeah, I'm set free. Oh Lord, I'm set free. Oh Lord, I'm set free. And bring down the walls of darkness. You have come to set the captives free. You bind up the brokenhearted and bring down the walls of darkness. You have come to set the captives free. And I'm set free. Oh Lord, I'm set free. Oh Lord. I'm free in you. Yeah, I'm set free. Oh Lord, I'm set free. Oh Lord, I'm set free. I'm free in you.
Oh, thank you. If the ushers want to come, we pray over the offering, Lord. Lord, we thank you for this day, Lord. We thank you for this chance to be here, Lord. Lord, we all have our struggles, Lord. But we're glad that you are in our lives, Lord. Lord, we just want to worship you and praise your holy name today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Your love is devoted. Like a ring of solid gold, like a vow that is tested, like a covenant of old. Your love is enduring through the winter rain and beyond the horizon, with mercy for today. Faithful you have been. That's why I sing your praise.
Just like I designed the plan for this parking garage, God has a plan for each one of us. And it's a good plan. You could have a firm foundation just like that building. Okay, maybe not just like that building.
We're all gonna get fired, aren't we?
We're lost.
Well, yeah, spiritually, we're all lost.
We've been by that tree like 5 times already.
We're in big trouble.
We're fine. Hey, guys, on a totally unrelated note, if you were to die today, do you know where you would end up eternally?
We don't want to die. That's why we hired you.
Can you hold this real quick? Well, welcome to town, man. I'm sure they're gonna love you here. Oh, hey, I know it's not really your thing, but I thought maybe you'd like to go to, church.
What? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. You just lost me $5 million because you didn't file some document.
A document? Like, what kind of document?
You tell me. You're the agent.
Oh, shoot. Is it the, It's the 10th. That's what this is for. So, I don't suppose you'd still like to go to church? Is that a no? Oh, that's probably a no.
Okay. Yes, sir, they're bringing your car around.
So how do you like the bodyguard gig?
I like it, sir. I'm a Christian, so, you know, that's what we're all about. Sacrifice, selflessness, putting other people first.
Ah! It's Al-Qaeda! No, I don't want to die. I just made my bucket list. Take him. No, he's a senator. No. Take him. I didn't even vote for him.
Don't put others first. No, I don't want to go first.
All right. Open up in your Bibles to Colossians chapter 3. Title of today's message is Work Hard. Whether we realize it or not, the way we work has a great effect on our witness for Jesus Christ. And we've been going through the book of Colossians, and we're in this Above All series. And now we're going to look at how Paul instructs the workers in the church at Colossae to let Christ be above all in their work. I know somebody told me one time I was preaching on work. I try to preach on this at least once a year because it's such a big part of our lives. Many of us spend more time at work than we spend at home. And so I try to talk about it a lot. Bible has a lot to say about work. How many of you know that our God is a working God? God created mankind. And then after he created Adam, even before he gave Adam a wife, he put him in the garden. And the Lord took the man and placed him in the Garden of Eden to work it and watch over it. Work is a part of our buildup. It's part of how we express the image and the nature of God. Our God's a working God. He's the original craftsman. He's the original builder. He's an investor. He's a homemaker. He is all of those things. He's a leader. He is the king of all the world, so he's in government. God understands work at every single level, and no matter how you work, whether it's inside of the home or outside of the home, whether you're retired and you're only working now for your spouse or for your kids or for your grandkids or whatever the case may be, we're still called to glorify God in how we work. And it's godly to work hard. And I remember one time I preached on this, and a good old boy from our church who will remain nameless, they said, it's kind of an oxymoron to have a preacher talk about work, isn't it? Because you only work once a week. And I said, well, the work would be a whole lot easier if I didn't have to work with people like you. And then that was the end of the conversation. Now, I'm just kidding. That's a joke. That's not how it went down. But honestly, working with people can be exhausting. Whatever kind of work you're in, chances are that you know what it's like to feel exhausted, to feel drained, to feel undervalued, overworked, and underprivileged. Anybody ever felt like that? You could say amen. The truth is, we need to do what Billy Graham said. He said this: read the Bible, work hard and honestly, and don't complain. Why? Because ultimately, we're working for the Lord. Amen? Work is a major part of our lives. It's something that we have to do, but it's not just something you have to do to earn a paycheck. Work is an opportunity to witness for the Lord. You can earn some money. Most people think, well, I work so that I do what I have to do so that I can earn some money. I can do some of the things that I want to do. The truth is your work is worship. When you ask somebody at work how their day is going, you hear things like, same stuff, different day. And of course, depending on who you're talking to, they probably don't edit the stuff. We all know what else they call it, right? What are you doing? How's everything going? Well, it's just another day of paradise. And if you've worked for any period of time, you've been in a job and you've had the feeling where you wanted to sing that old country music song, you can take this job and shove it. Hello. That is all natural. That is all a part of the human experience. What Paul is trying to get us to understand here is that our work is a way that we can glorify God. Our work should be an act of worship, and every one of us should see our work as missions work. I don't care whether it happens in the garage or on the job site or out in the woods or in the office or in the bank. It doesn't matter what you're doing, we need to see it as worship, because ultimately we're not working for our company or our boss or our kids or our grandkids. We're working for Jesus, and we need to keep Jesus above all in our work. Amen? And you may or may not love your job, but you do love your Savior, and you want to reflect well on Him. Amen? So I'm going to do 3 points on work, and we'll go through this passage together. If you want to stand with me. We'll read Colossians chapter 3. Verses 22, and we're going to read through chapter 4, verse 1. And I'll put it up on the screen. You can follow along. This is what Paul says. Slaves, obey your human masters in everything. Don't work only while being watched in order to please men, but work wholeheartedly, fearing the Lord. Whatever you do, do it enthusiastically as something done for the Lord and not for men, knowing that you will receive the reward of an inheritance from the Lord, because you serve the Lord Christ. For the wrongdoer will be paid back for whatever wrong he has done, and there is no favoritism. Masters, supply your slaves with what is right and fair, since you know that you too have a master in heaven. You may be seated. We have to talk about a little bit of background before we kind of move through our points here. You need to understand something, that in the Roman world, there was approximately 60 million slaves in the Roman Empire. That was the employment institution of the day. And the Bible is not endorsing slavery when we read this passage. You have to understand the context. Most people who worked as slaves for other wealthy landowners and for other healthy citizens. And wealthy citizens. Maybe they were healthy, maybe they weren't, I don't know. But anyway, and many of those slaves were well educated, and they worked and they managed households and they had very prestigious jobs. And so when we read this, don't think, well, and this passage of Scripture has been abused throughout history to say, well, the Bible endorsed slavery. No, Paul told slaves in 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 21, that if they had the chance, they needed to secure their freedom. You have to understand, when Paul's writing this, Christianity is not in the majority. It is a minority movement, and they really had no political sway. So the best thing for them to do in order to preach the gospel and grow the church was to work within the system they were in. But the Bible, please don't misunderstand. The Bible never condones slavery. Slavery is wrong. It is a sin. And it is for freedom that Christ has set us free. Amen? So when we look at this today, it's really important you understand the historical context. And when we preach it, we're preaching from the aspect of employee and employer. We're not coming at this from slave and master. We're looking at employee and employer. So, and although your job can be a grind and it can be very restricting and overly demanding, we have a higher purpose above the 9-to-5 grind. How do you keep Christ above all in your work? Well, point number one, very simply, he says it here in verse 22. You have to let your work be a witness for God. Let your work be a witness for God. It doesn't, and you don't have to work in a church to do this. In fact, it's easier for everyone who is working outside in the secular world to do this than it is for the preacher. You, wherever you're at, you can be a witness. On the job site, you can be a witness. I mean, if you've ever worked on a construction site, Trix, Travis, people need Jesus. Amen? If you've ever worked in a bank, if you've ever worked in any kind of financial institution, man, those people need Jesus. If you've ever just been a homemaker and worked inside the home with your own kids, you know, man, your kids really need Jesus. So it doesn't matter where you work or how you work. Use it as a witness for God. This is what he says in verse 22. He says, obey your human masters in everything. Don't work only while being watched in order to please men, but work wholeheartedly fearing the Lord. It's easy to do what you're supposed to do when the boss is right there. And we've all heard that old expression, right? The boss comes to you and he says, well, tomorrow I'm going to be out. I'm taking a personal day. And everybody in the office goes, well, we can do whatever we want tomorrow, right? Because when the cat's away, the mice will play. Shouldn't be that way for the Christian, right? Because we're ultimately not just working for our employer. We're working for the Lord. And you have to understand, this doesn't always play well with other employees. If you're working alongside many other people who have that mentality, and this is the mentality in the secular workforce, they're not going to pay me any extra. So, therefore, I'll just do the bare minimum because I'm going to get paid the same whether I work hard or whether I work very little. You ever heard that kind of mentality? That's not the Christian's mentality. Paul says, look, even when your master is there, when he's not there, when your boss is there, when they're not there, whether you're being seen or whether you're not being seen by any human being, work wholeheartedly. Why? Because you're working for the Lord. Your work is a witness for God. So guess what? If you do bad work, guess what? Just like the video, right? That's a bad witness. The man who says, you know, God has a plan for your life, just like I had a plan for this building, and then the building falls down. What does that say about God? So we have to understand that if we do poor work, if we do a poor job, it reflects poorly on our Lord and Savior. Now, I remember I worked at the shipyard 2005 to 2006 as a marine electrician. Didn't work there very long because we moved back home to be closer to my mom and dad after we had Madison. We wanted to be close to grandparents. And my mom pretty much told me, either you're going to move or I'm going to move. And I'm like, well, the country seems nice. So we moved back. While I worked there, the shipyard was a very unionized place, and there were people that had been there for many, many years, and the whole mantra was, do as little as possible. This was the work crew of every mantra, and if you tried to do more than what was, listen, this is all we're going to do today. This is it. Don't do anything more. If you did more, man, I tell you, you caught a lot of heat from your coworkers. And I remember this old guy had been working there for 18 years. He says, listen, and they called me preacher boy at work. They knew I had come out of Bible college and I was working and starting a family. And they say, listen, we ain't saving the world here, preacher boy. We're just collecting paychecks. They're not going to pay you anymore if you do that hard work. Don't worry. You're going to make the rest of us look bad. And I said, listen, man, I can't do that because I ultimately know that I'm working for the Lord here. And maybe you're not trying to save the world, but Jesus gave his life to save the world. And I want to help him. And part of how we do that is by doing this job. It actually made my job a lot harder instead of making it easier. Because then I had people working against me instead of doing their job. Sometimes that happens, but you know what? Take a lesson from Jacob. Take a lesson from Joseph. Take a lesson from King David. Look throughout the Old Testament and you will see ultimately when you work as a witness for God, people may forget you, deny you, try to put you down, try to cheat you, but ultimately God is the one who's going to pay you. Amen. Amen. Let your work be a witness for God. Why? Because you're not doing it to please people. You're doing it to please the Lord. Point number two, let your work be worship to God. Let it be a witness for God, but we also have to let it be worship to God. Look at verse 23. He says, whatever you do, do it enthusiastically. I love that because there's all kinds of different ways to make money. There's all different kinds of ways to work, and no one way is better than the other way. God creatively made you. He created you with unique personality, with a unique style, with a unique gift set. Praise God. I'm a much better preacher than I would be a carpenter, right? Listen, Trix, if you hired me to be a carpenter, there wouldn't be a square room in the house, okay? I'm just telling you, nothing would be right. That's not how I'm gifted. I'm gifted this way, and so I work this way. You work however you're gifted. And so you have to find that sweet spot, and then you have to let your worship be to God. Whatever you do, however you work, and listen, whatever your job is, it comes with a unique set of stressors. It comes with a unique set of circumstances. It comes with a unique set of coworkers who are, now listen, if you work for yourself and you hate your coworker, that's your personal problem, okay? We need to have another conversation, all right? Because you ultimately probably can't fire yourself, even though you may want to. That's a whole nother topic. But every job is different. Every workplace has that same kind of underlying tension, drama, dog eat dog, rat race, kind of hamster in the wheel kind of feel. You know what I'm talking about? Yeah. You have got to understand. We have got to understand. Paul is telling the workers in this passage, let your work be worship to God. Do it enthusiastically. Put on a happy face. Why? Because you're doing it for the Lord. Now, I love this word in verse 23. It's translated into the English enthusiastically. The Greek word is psyche. It's the word that's most often translated for soul. I like that. You know how you work enthusiastically for the Lord? You got to put a little soul into it. You put a little oomph into it. You put a little gumption behind it. It means that you do a little bit more, you do it a little bit harder, and you do it not because you want to prove yourself to anybody else, but because you want to worship God. You got to put a little soul into your work. You got to dig down deep, and you got to find it. Don't just go through the motions. Don't just get into that. Oh, it's the same stuff. Oh, well, they're telling us this today. God only knows what they're going to tell us tomorrow. Well, they may tell you one thing today. They may tell you another thing tomorrow. Ultimately, you're working for the Lord. The check's still going to be in the mail. Do it for the Lord and make it an act of worship. Because complaining about it, what does that change? Does that change your job description? No. Does grumbling about it and saying, well, they just don't care about us. They don't care about, they're always doing their own. Listen, that's the beautiful thing about living in a free market capitalistic type of environment. You don't like your job? Go find another one. Work hard. That's why we need to stay democratic. That's why we need to stay capitalistic and not go socialist. Amen? Vote on Tuesday and vote the right way. Anyway, I'm not going on that this morning. That's not what I'm supposed to be preaching on, but I'm saying that's at stake here too. We've got to work hard. When you work, you are worshiping the Lord. Have you ever seen somebody that was skilled at their job? Have you ever seen somebody that really put in 110%, that went above and beyond? You can tell there's something a little bit different about the work that they do. That should be the key characteristic for every single Christian. Amen? Paul did say, the one who does not work, neither shall he eat. So work hard. And there's people who can't work, they're not physically able, that's one thing. But taking advantage, slacking off, just doing what you have to do so that you don't get fired, that's no way to keep a job, and it's certainly no way to worship the Lord. Knowing you have to do it as something done for the Lord and not for men. Paul's trying to tell us to stand out for Jesus. When everyone else is complaining and griping and mumbling and grumbling, we should stand out. We should stand out. We should speak life. We should be empathetic and maybe use that situation to point to Christ. Now, you have to say this too on this. You can't worship your work. I understand that there are people in our congregation, people in the world, they make money on commission. But the only time I hear from you I don't want it to be when you're going to sell me something new. What your new pyramid scheme is. What your new this is. Listen, we don't worship our work. We work so that we can provide, so that we can be a blessing, but we should not be workaholics. That's not worshiping your work. If you're overworked and overstressed, chances are you're not contributing enough time to family and to the Lord and to church. There's a lot of people who, instead of worshiping God through their work, they just worship their work and they work. It goes back to the video we showed last week. There's not going to be anybody on their deathbed that says, I wish I would have spent more time at work and less time at home. I wish I would have missed more baseball games so that I could have gotten that project done. No. People aren't going to say that. You know what really matters? Working for the Lord and doing your job for Him. So don't worship it. Now, you have to promote whatever, but we don't live to work. We live for Christ, and then we work to live so that we can build His kingdom and glorify God. Amen? With whatever talents and skills He's given us. I love that God's a master builder. Our God is a good worker, and there's good news this morning. You may not like where you're at in your life. The good news is He's still working on you. The Bible says in the book of Ephesians, chapter 2, verse 10, that you are His workmanship. Stay on that potter's wheel. Everything we go through may not be pleasant. Many times, since we are at work the majority of our time as working adults, God uses those moments to shape our character, to build our lives, to teach us lessons, gives us opportunity to love and forgive the unlovable and the unforgivable. Amen? So we have to let Him use that, and we have to let Him work in that. Put some heart and soul into that daily grind and see what happens. And point number three, you will be rewarded from God. You will be rewarded from God. Verse 24, he says, knowing that you will receive the reward of inheritance from the Lord because you serve the Lord Jesus Christ. You have to understand something in the first century. The slave had no rights in a household. The slave had no inheritance. The slave had nothing. They had no 401k. They had no retirement. They had nothing beyond whatever they were given for the work they did at the moment. That's a totally different economic system than what we have now. But what Paul is saying is this: don't cheat your boss. Don't try to squirrel anything away. Listen, you're going to be rewarded and paid by God, so work hard and work honestly. Don't try to get a little extra money illegally on the side. Work honestly. Work with integrity. Why? Because you're working for the Lord, and ultimately, verse 25, the wrongdoer is going to be paid back for whatever wrong he has done, and there is no favoritism. God's going to judge every worker according to the same holy criteria. So understand that he's going to pay you. And I'm here to tell you this morning, God pays really, really good. I don't know about you, but eternal life is worth more than anything else you can get on a paycheck. Amen. Peace and joy and eternal security is worth a whole lot more to me than immediate financial security. Hello. You're going to get paid by God. He's telling these people, don't get frustrated. Don't get discouraged. Don't be dismayed. You're going to be rewarded from God. And while everybody else is hustling and working and skimming off the top or taking it from somewhere else, don't be like all those other people who are cheating and thieving and scandalous. Be people of integrity and serve the Lord honestly. You know, in some professions, even today, it's still really hard to find honest work, isn't it? It's even harder to find honest workers. Why? Because everybody's working, try to get ahead, try to cut corners, try to slash costs, try whatever you do, it's not worth. Cutting costs is not worth vandalizing your integrity before a holy God. It's not worth it. So don't do that. Don't take any shortcuts. Shortcuts in life when it comes to trying to get ahead, I have found that the more shortcuts you take, the more lost you become. Do it the right way. Do it the hard way. Do it the way that's going to glorify God. Why? Because ultimately your paycheck is going to come from Him. Don't you know that the greatest reward you will ever receive is going to be based on something you did not earn for the Christian? The greatest inheritance you ever receive is going to be awarded to you, not for something you have done, but for something Christ has done. Hello? Doesn't mean we should be lazy. Absolutely not. But it does mean that we should honor the Lord. Why? Because He pays really, really well. He is our provider. He is our source, and He will never leave us or forsake us. You love that verse? God will never leave us or forsake us. Do you know that in the book of Hebrews, the 12th chapter, that verse is actually the 13th chapter. He will never leave you or forsake you. That verse is actually in the context of money. It's saying, don't be a lover of money. I'm going to go there real quick and I will read it for you. Hebrews chapter 13. I didn't mark it. I should have marked it. Party foul on the pastor. All right. Your life, Hebrews 13:5, your life should be free from the love of money. Somebody said it's easy not to fall in love with it because I ain't never had it. That's a whole nother story. Your life should be free from the love of money. Be satisfied with what you have, for God Himself has said, I will never leave you or forsake you. Therefore, we can boldly say, the Lord is my helper. I will not be afraid. What can man do to me? How often have we heard that verse in context? We use it in the context of loneliness. The Bible is using it, and it certainly applies to that. The Bible is using it in the context of you don't have to worry about going broke or about starving if you're a Christian, because God will be with you and He will provide for you. Amen? A person may sign your paycheck, but the ability to earn that paycheck comes from God. He is high above your employer, and somebody should say amen to that. He is high above it. He will make sure that you are blessed for your labor. Employees and employers have to remember, you both have to answer to the big boss man. There's going to come a day when employers, that's why he addresses employers too. He says, masters, make sure you give your workers what is right and fair, because you too have a master in heaven. So if you're an employer, if you're a manager, listen, you got to supervise in a godly way. You can't show favoritism because God doesn't show favoritism. You can't show favoritism just because you know them or because they worked with your dad or your granddad or you grew up together. No, what we should look at is the content of work and the content of character. Amen? Whole lot of people getting promoted and getting ahead in the workplace, and it has nothing to do with their work ability or their work ethic. Has to do with who they know, with where they're from, has to do with a whole lot of other things. And the Bible is saying, look, you have to make sure that you're fair and honest and people of integrity. Why? Because that's how God is. So the worker who slacks off, steals, cuts corners, they're going to be punished by God. And if you're not being paid well, you shouldn't read this as an employee and say, well, does this mean that I can't leave my job? Absolutely not. Don't burn your bridges. Put in a notice. And if you find a better opportunity, well, then go and serve the Lord in another opportunity. if he gives you that freedom to go. If you're an employer and you're working with somebody who cheats and who's just a cancer in the office and spreads gossip, doesn't mean you can't fire them. If they're not doing the job, then fire them. But do it in a godly way. Do it above board. And whatever you do, do it with all your heart and with all your soul for the Lord. I love Elizabeth Elliot. She said this quote, and this is what I think the mentality we should have. She said this. She said, work is a blessing. Amen. God so arranged the world so that work is necessary. He gives us hands and strength to do it. The enjoyment of leisure would be nothing if we only had leisure. You know what makes rest worth it? A good hard day's work. It's like my granddaddy always said, a good hard day's work never hurt nobody. And he had good English. I'm telling you, granddaddy just put it out there like that. You don't appreciate rest if all you do is lounge around if you're lazy. You have to work hard in order to enjoy rest. It's the joy of work that enables us to enjoy rest. Just as the experiences of hunger and thirst make food and drink pleasurable and desirable. If you're always going around eating, you don't know how to appreciate a good home-cooked meal. But if you go out and you work all day long, and you're sweating your butt off, and you're working your butt off, and you finally come home, and you work so hard because you got a deadline, you didn't even take a lunch break, and you get home and you walk into the house and it's that pot roast has been cooking all day, and it hits your nostrils. Oh man, don't you enjoy that when you get to sit down and then eat and rest and enjoy the evening? Isn't that great? What makes that great is the hard day's work. And that's what we have to do. We have to ensure that we're allowing our work to be worship, allowing our work to be a witness for Christ. And we have to remember, you're going to be rewarded by God. You may never be thanked by your earthly employer for what you did, but you know what? When you get into glory, you're going to be paid for everything you did in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. So I'm going to run through these 10 practical tips. These are Pastor Dave's. How do we do this? How do we allow our work to be a witness? How do we allow our work to be worship? And how do we keep in mind that we'll be rewarded by God and do a good job? This is how you do it. Number one, do more than the minimum. Do more than the minimum. Don't settle for being one of those people who say, I'm just going to check the box and I'm just going to do just enough. Do more than the minimum. Number two, show up early. Winners show up early. The early bird gets the worm. Hello. Show up early. If you're supposed to be there at 8 o'clock and you get there at 8 o'clock, you're late. I got real quiet on that one. Right? If you're supposed to be there at 8 o'clock, be there at 7:45. Be there at 20 minutes till late. Hey, give yourself time. Stay late if necessary. If the job's not done and there's still daylight and there's still an opportunity to do it, stay late. Stay late if necessary. Man, it's getting awful quiet on these. We don't like this. Don't abuse leave. Don't abuse leave. If you ain't sick, get out of the bed and go to work. Don't abuse leave. Don't bash your boss. None of those other people that are complaining about your boss are the boss. You know why they're not the boss? Because they're too busy complaining about the boss instead of putting in the work to become the boss. Don't join in the workplace gossip, because if they will air so-and-so's dirty laundry, as soon as you walk away, they're going to talk about everything you just put on Facebook. Do the dirty jobs. Do those dirty jobs that nobody else wants to do. And please, for the love of all that's holy, don't whine. The only thing worse than working with somebody you don't like is working with somebody you don't like that whines all the time. The job is the job. The job is the job. Zip your lip and do the work. Do your best work. Do your best work and talk less and work more. Amen? Unless your job has to do with talking. Right? So I'm going to apply this right now, and I'm actually going to end this service. I'm going to put this final quote up from David Livingston. This is what he said. This was a man who was a missionary, took the gospel of Jesus Christ all over the world. He simply said this: fear God and work hard. Fear God and work hard. Why? Because there's somebody other than your employer watching you. And chances are all your other employees and co-workers are watching you. They know what you say you stand for. Don't let bad work hinder good news. Whatever you do, do it enthusiastically. Do it with all your heart and with all your soul for the Lord Jesus Christ. Because you know, most of the time, the only thing that you can actually control about your job, you know what it is? Your attitude and your amount of effort. That's two things. I said the only thing, and then I gave you two things. Two things that you can control. You may not be able to control when you go back to school or when you don't go back to school. You're not going to be able to control whether it's going to rain or whether it's going to pour. On the day you had all this work lined up, you can't control any of that. The only thing you can control, your attitude towards your work and the amount of effort that you put into it. You know what should govern those things? The fact that you are not working for men. You're not working for women. You're working in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen? So fear God and work hard. I'm going to ask you to bow your head and close your eyes, and I want the worship team to come. Maybe you're here today and you say, you know what, Pastor Dave? I'm struggling in my life. I just don't have contentment. A lot of times we struggle with not being content, and it works itself out in how we work. I just want to encourage you today that there is a God who sees you, who loves you, who's called you, and ultimately you're working for Him. Find the joy in working for the Lord. And we're going to sing this song, Ever Be, and remember that even while you're at work, even when you're dealing with that boss or that coworker that makes you want to fuss and cuss, listen, let His praises ever be on your lips. And whatever you do, do it in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And before you go and do another day of work, first of all, you need to accept the work that Jesus did on the cross. Because it's the work that God has done that ensures your ability to have eternal life and to have that eternal inheritance. So accept God's completed work in Jesus. Then walk in obedience before Him and work hard in His name. Let's stand together and sing this song.
Like a ring of solid gold, like a vow that is tested, like a covenant of hope. Your love is enduring through the winter rain and beyond the horizon, with mercy for today. Faithful you will be. You pledge yourself to me.
Fear God and work hard. Amen. I was having a discussion one day with someone and they said, well, you know, Pastor Dave, I'm not really worried about work. The Bible said not to worry. Said that if God clothes the lilies of the field and the flowers of the field and he gives birds what they need to eat, I know he's going to take care of me. And I'll never forget it. I'm usually not very clever or quick. Most of you know that. But what popped into my head was this. God may provide the food for the bird, but he doesn't throw it into the nest. They have to go out and they have to get it. Amen? They have to go out and they have to gather it. He's given us the ability. He's given us the purpose, the overarching purpose. And listen, after you retire, you get to work for yourself. Find something to do. Do it enthusiastically for the Lord, not for people, so that your reward will be from God and you will be blessed and build the kingdom. Amen? Amen. Let's work hard. When I hear people talk about Christians, I want them to be talking about the most dedicated, hardest working people that they know. Let's do that for Jesus. Amen. Lord, we thank you. I thank you to be in the presence of some hard working people. We thank you, oh God, that it's through the hardships of life that we learn to enjoy the benefits of rest. We enjoy the benefits of blessing. Lord, I know that we're all in different situations, and right now work has been something with people being furloughed, people's jobs being uncertain, people not wanting to work, people not sure where to work, all these types of things. Help us to remember that we work for you. If we'll dedicate ourselves to you and allow you to work through our work, we can bring people closer to Jesus. So give us the strength, oh God, to be a witness for you. When we leave here, give us the strength to worship you, not just through song, not just through your word, but through the work that you've given us to do. And help us all to remember that payday is coming someday, and you pay really well to the righteous. Bless your people. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. God bless you. Go in the peace and joy of the Lord. My name's Dave, and I'm the pastor here at Antioch Baptist Church. I just want to thank you for joining us for this time of praise and worship. I hope that it impacted your life and that it inspired you to take your relationship with God to the next level. If you were watching today and you felt convicted by the Lord to accept Christ as Savior and Lord of your life, I want you to pray this simple prayer with me. Just say, Dear Jesus, I'm a sinner. I need you to make me new. I invite you into my life to be my Lord and to be my master. I believe that you rose from the dead, and I believe that you are the Son of God, and I believe that you will return to the earth again to take me home to be with you. Jesus, thank you for saving me. Thank you for dying for my sin. I receive you now as my Lord and Savior. Amen. If you prayed that prayer and if you responded to that message today, we'd love to hear about it. I want you to contact us here at the church and let us know about the impact that it's had on your life so that we can celebrate with you and so that we can give you some resources to help you in furthering your walk with Jesus. Thank you so much for tuning in. God bless you. And remember to love, connect, go, and grow.
If you've been walking the same old road for miles and miles, if you've been hearing the same old voice, tell the same old lies, if you're trying to fill the same old holes inside, there's a better life.